wives of my childhood. I still come back to what they hoped for. Surely they were heroes, those women of sinks and supermarkets, of beautiful salads and 99 ways to use hamburger, daring the man of the house to find their casserole wanting. I felt ashamed leaving my starfoot track on their bright linoleum, for they have raised children who sing in the corridors, who send their box tops for personalized miniature robots, who find their way up three flights of stairs to sell me Girl Scout cookies. I know these dwarf hands. They are my own. And the soldierly manner counting back my change like bounty. Little women, little pilgrims, tell your mothers I did not find the heavenly vineyards, though I drank from the vine. Tell them in the early days of my longing, there were men, yes, and as men are, always the gift and hoard of an absent woman, mother, wife, or ghost. Say you found me alone and well, that I showed you where I sit to take the morning sun, here by this window where the dark comes also. Say from my heart I make the soft wind and the keen, bounty when there is no sun, banners, brave leaves, brave shadow, brave in every labor, none to keep. I got the idea for this poem from listening to a story my mother told. My mother was raised in the Ozarks, and she would describe how the young men would come to court, and they would either come on horseback or they would walk, so that when they left, you could see them leaving for quite a distance, going back over the fields. And I always liked that idea of someone coming to visit you, and then you would be able to see them for a long while after as they left you. So I had a very difficult parting at one point, and I remember really hating cars at that time. And this hatred of cars gets into this poem, entitled Painted Steps. I was coming down the wide painted steps. I wanted to go with you in your leaving, the way a farmer would go behind his horse to keep the rows straight. Even when we reached the corridor and I knew the field would not get there in time, I thought, surely he'll find a way to walk from this so I can see him harmed and unsure, like a man who would turn back if he could, if the field were not coming late under its flock of birds. The last moments when you leaned from the car, even then I thought, if only we could believe this as never, the field would have mercy, would come down around us like a fine healing rain. I stood where the car had been and looked out as far as I could, believing so the light would deepen and drop off, the field empty and settle one patch of sky. But no, I'm not one of those who changes an ending to keep the moment true. Think of me as one who lives things quickly, cruelly, as a car could live it. Think of me as one who stands in the streets, speeding past with the stopped wheel in my hands and the radio, its small hearth flickering along the trees ahead. My sister went through a period of difficulty walking because she had an operation on her foot, and this put her at my mercy. And I never really realized how it might be to be in this nurse position for weeks at a time. The title of this is called I Take Care of You. A lantern dashes by in the grass. Already there is a rhythm to keep. I bring you your face cloth steaming. I prop your leg with pillows and pull the bright afghan over you. The woman next to you in the hospital still speaks, though we have left her for home. They bring me flowers, but no hairbrush. My friends, what do they know there in their houses? I bring you your hairbrush. Your hair hangs over the back of the chair. It's waterfall, the first halfway glance from the cliff. When I brush, it falls and falls. You are my good pony. I braid every fine hair so your neck shows proud to advantage. They are coming to see you. Your eyes prance about the room. You take the mirror from the tray and the flowers flash up around your face. Behind you, I recede to a patch of wallpaper from our childhood, put on askew so the pony can't line up with his cart. His blinders are flared, his, and he is noble in his abrupt field, pulling one of the many nautical lanterns. His driver, what confidence, though the horse is missing. His red cap, his half a face, sliced by a strip of magnolia. I raise the blind, and a bolt of houses steps toward us in the shocked light. Today, today, the light says, though the porch bulb glimmers. A man with a Dalmatian opens the house over your desk. Hand me that, you say, and I do. The little pony rages through our lives, dragging its benevolent lantern. Take me home, the white-haired woman says. It is 2 days ago, and we know her home is a span of hope that has swept her by. Lean back, I say, drink this. We are a long way off and covered up. Someone is coming to see us. The next poem is entitled Unanswered Letter. Your silence is leaning toward judgment. Yesterday, I bragged, writing to calm my paranoid friend, that I never assume the worst when my pals don't write. Now, assuming the worst, I think what I must have done or not done. Surely some recognition will brand the door of my house or rich attention flutter down. How natural in silence to credit delay with intention, like the word or insisting on water. The need also to advise the self around exaggeration, i.e. nobody loves me, because nothing is coming back, and next to nothing, not to act like a transistor radio left on into the night, voices singing like an ear baffled in the rain, or someone refused because they think so. Those others you loved elsewhere, you miss what they haven't said. They belong to some permission to go on as more than yourself, a clarity that adds you back to all you cast off, as when you want to be the good light of a lamp, scanning the firmament, or rain its pleasure with an open boat. So what is unanswered keeps you coming back to yourself, telling you what you wanted only when it didn't come, having now to make up this difference. Even moments you think empty, the world doesn't stop speaking. The windshield blurred suddenly by a sighting of gravestones before you are driven through the underpass. This poem was written for a student. After you've worked with students, you sometimes wonder what it is you have done for them, what they're going to do with it. And the title is Stopping Place. In those other rooms, we may not be so favored. And if the man in the green lab coat enters, at least we have met him in hallways enough times to stay ahead of what he may do, actually. The way we recognize a mermaid having studied fish and women who swim with their breasts showing. The space we breathe in is a blink in the sun. We start our engines and go. For someone else, it's over, like the 24-year-old man in the cancer ward, found with his book opened to career opportunities, his pulse shut for good. A true story my doctor tells me to salute her growing stamina for ultimate extremities. My engine wants to leave the book open too, or to close it in with distance, like the Japanese poet Mutsu Takahashi, who said, "Untalented and ignorant as I am, I wish to pursue poetry at least until I am 85. Reading him, even in translation, is to stroke open the eyes of a dove. You want to fly for it or to speak with feathers. Its wings glint over the waters. Dove, dove, where did I go with you now?" Gray eyes. When she speaks, it is like coming onto a grave at the edge of a woods, softly, so we do not enter or wholly turn away. Such speech is the breath a brush makes through hair, opening into time after the stroke. A tree is bending, but the bird doesn't land. One star earthbound reports a multitude of unyielding others. It cannot help its falling into the dull brown earth of someone's backyard, where in daylight a hand reaches in front of the mower and tosses it, dead stone, aside. We who saw it fall are still crashing with light into the housetops, tracing in the mind that missing trajectory, rainbow of darkness where we were, children murmuring, "There, over there," while the houses slept and slept on. Years later, she is still nesting on the light of that plundered moment, her black hair frozen to her head with yearning, saying, "Father, I am a colder green where the mower cut a swath, and I lay down, and the birds that have no use for song passed over me like a shovel fall." She closed her eyes. It was early morning, daybreak. Some bees were dying on my wing, humming so you could hardly hear. The hug. A woman is reading a poem on the street, and another woman stops to listen. We stop, too, with our arms around each other. The poem is being read and listened to out here in the open. Behind us, no one is entering or leaving the houses. Suddenly, a hug comes over me, and I'm giving it to you like a variable star shooting light off to make itself comfortable, then subsiding. I finish, but keep on holding you. A man walks up to us, and we know he hasn't come out of nowhere, but if he could, he would have. He looks homeless because of how he needs. "Can I have one of those?" he asks you, and I feel you nod. I'm surprised you don't tell him how it is, that I am yours, only yours, etc., exclusive as a nose to its face. Love, that's what we're talking about. Love that nabs you with "for me only" and holds on. So I walk over to him and put my arms around him and try to hug him like I mean it. He's got on an overcoat so thick I can't feel him past it. I'm starting the hug and thinking, how big a hug is this supposed to be? How long shall I hold this hug? Already we could be eternal. His arms falling over my shoulders, my hands not meeting behind his back. He is so big. I put my head into his chest and snuggle in. I lean into him. I lean my blood and my wishes into him. He stands for it. This is his, and he's starting to give it back so well. I know he's getting it, this hug. So truly, so tenderly, we stop having arms, and I don't know if my lover has walked away or what, or if the woman is still reading the poem, or the houses. What about them, the houses? Clearly, a little permission is a dangerous thing. But when you hug someone, you want it to be a masterpiece of connection, the way the button on his coat will leave the imprint of a planet in my cheek when I walk away, when I try to find some place to go back to. I worked for a blind man, but it so happened that he was employed by the police department in their research and development department. And my job was to read to him and to attend trials. And I met some of his friends during this time. One of them was a man who was becoming a lawyer, and he was losing his sight slowly. Before this man went blind, I wanted to take him up into the mountains behind where I was raised in the Olympic mountain range. It's called Reading Aloud. When the light was shutting down on you, I said, behind my home is a palace of mountains. I wanted you to see them, regal, in their shawls of snow, above the working houses of the town. I told them to you the way a mother tells death to a child, so it seems possible to go there and stay, leaving everyone behind, saying softly, everyone is coming, so it is only a little while alone. You were slipping from our days like an opposite ripeness, still clinging to the light. Each time you guessed your way home by the edges, I saw my own image freed in the streets of your memory, my face like a time traveler's, forever young, and every place you touched gave way. I called it my year of the blind. I was working for your friend who lived a blindness he was born to. What did he lose? Noises, that's all he knows, you said, would have no comfort or instruction. Long days I read aloud to your friend the words that are the fountain sounds of the mind, causing light to fall inside itself over the missing shapes of the world. What do you think when I say wings, I asked once. Angels, birds, he said, and I saw he could fly with either. Once about diamonds, their light a hiss in the rain when the cars pass. But you were memory taunted by what was left of your sight, the face of a beautiful grade school teacher marooned in your childhood. You cried against her neck and were grown. The day we set out for the mountains, I strapped your sleeping bag to your back. The woman who would call you husband bound up her long hair and said your name each time you fell and got up, David, David. When we came to the chasm where a moss-slick log was the only bridge, we looked down for you at the river stones, the water over and over them. She loved you too much and could not lead you. I took your hand and put all my sight there, balancing between trust and the swiftness we could fall to, walking backwards so my grip was steady. When the river sound rocked us to either side, I fell deeper for how you gave up to me and to the river where we walked like two improbable Christs held up by the doubt that is the body. When I let your hand drop on the far side and we sank in the earth, the habit of thanks was in me. Who could go with us after that, though they joined us? When I think of you in the years that have passed us, I see a river under you, and always you are walking into the shouting light of water, and again the wet smell of cloth as when someone has been lifted free with their breath still in them. I know your walking is the other side of courage and has no regard, like the cold faces of the mountains, seen from a childhood window when the house is empty, when with our many hands we have rushed through the rooms, adding darkness, adding the words, mother, father, and no one answers back. Death of the Horses by Fire. We have seen a house in the sleeping town stand still for a fire, and the others, where their windows knew it, clothed in the remnants of a dream happening outside them. We have seen the one door aflame in the many windows, the steady procession of the houses trembling in heat light, their well-tended yards, the trellis of cabbage roses scrawled against the porch, flickering white, whiter where a darkness breathes back. How many nights the houses have burned through to morning. We stood in our blankets like a tribe made to witness what a god could do. We saw the house built again in daylight and children coming from it, as what a house restores to itself in rooms so bright they do not forget, even when the father, when the mother dies. Kitchen of your childhoods, we shout at the old men alive on the benches in the square. Their good black eyes glitter back at us, a starfall of homecomings. Only when the horses began to burn in the funnel of light, hurrying in one place on the prairie, did we begin to suspect our houses, to doubt at our meals and pleasures. We gathered on the ridge above the horses, above the blue smoke of the grasses, and they whirled in the close circle of the death that came to them, rippling in like a deep moon to its water. With the hills in all directions, they stood in the last of their skies and called to each other to save them. This poem is called Bird Window Flying. The title is hyphenated title, as if your mother might wake up and name you those things that she first saw in Indian fashion. If we had been given names to love each other by, I would take this one from you, bird flying all day in my woodhouse. The door is open as when you came to it, into it, as space between branches. Never trust doors, you tell the window, the small of your body flung against the white bay. At dusk, when I walked in with my armload of green alder, I could see the memory of light shining water through your wings. You were gray with it. The window had aged you with promises. I thought the boats, the gulls, should have stilled you by now. When I cupped my hands in their shadows, warm over the heart wings, I saw the skin of light between my fingers, haloed and glowing. 3 steps I took with you, for you, 3 light years traveling to your sky, beak and claw of you, the soft burr of flight at my finger bones. If I take a lover for every tree, I will not have again such an opening as when you flew from me. I have gone in to build my fire. All the walls, all the wings of my house are burning, the flames of me, the long hair unbraiding. Snowheart. In our houses, the snow keeps us traveling. It says your life is where you are. The phone all day ringing by itself over the next lot isn't for you. The man with the perfect haircut makes a track across the lawn, holding his books like abreast. Snowheart, you have said, don't cut your black hair. Love's the only debt. He's up again and riding the best mare 10 miles by moonlight, the spruce-backed fiddle under his arm. Dance us the next one, too. If day comes, don't tell. Let the horse go home alone. Snowheart, someone's horse circles the near house. There is snow on its back. Just read one last poem. This is a poem which was generated by a story told to me by a young man whose mother was dying of cancer. His father was a doctor, and his father found it very difficult to minister to his own wife. So the son took over these duties. And he said to me that he thought it was a very rare experience because he was able to give back the kind of care to his mother that she had given to him when he was an infant. And that the strange reversal of roles, that he thought that it had allowed him to get rid of a lot of hang-ups that he had had about his own body and about the body of others. Each bird walking. Not while, but long after he had told me, I thought of him washing his mother, his bending over the bed and taking back the covers. There was a basin of water, and he dipped a wash rag in and out of the basin, the rag dripping a little onto the sheet as he turned from the bedside to the nightstand and back, there being no place on her body he shouldn't touch because he had to, and she helped him, moving the little she could, lifting so he could wipe under her arms, a dipping motion in the hollow. Then, working up from the feet, around the ankles, over the knees, and this last, opening her thighs and running the rag firmly and with the cleaning thought, up through her crotch, between the lips, over the V of thin hairs, as though he were a mother who had the excuse of cleaning to touch with love and indifference the secret parts of her child, to graze the sleepy sexlessness in its waiting to find out what to do for the sake of the body, for the sake of what only the body can do for itself. So his hand softly at the place of his birthlight, and she, eyes deepened and closed in the dim room. And because he told me her death as important to his being with her, I could love him another way, not of the body alone or of its making, but carried in the white spires of trembling until what spirit, what breath we were was shaken from us, small then the word holy. He turned her on her stomach and washed the blades of her shoulders, the small of the back. That's good, she said. That's enough. On our lips that morning, the tart juice of the mothers, so strong in remembrance, no asking, no giving, and what you said, this being the end of our loving, so as not to hurt the closer one to you, made me look to see what was left of us with our sex taken away. Tell me, I said, something I can't forget. Then the story of your mother, and when you finished, I said, that's good, that's enough. Thank you. Thank you very much.
I save your coat, but you lose it later. It was a coat worth keeping, even with you in no condition to keep track, your mind important to things you were seeing out the window. We had changed seats on the bus, so a little breeze could catch our faces. The coat was back there in a spot of sunlight, its leather smell making a halo of invitation around it. We got off near the planetarium and were heading for stars, just to make one eye do the work of two and bring back ghost light was making us forgetful. Then I looked at you, strange without your coat, which I knew you loved and had paid an incredible price for, as if you had tried to buy something that would make you sorry. The bus was whirring itself into traffic, its passengers locked into destinations. I ran with everyone until they stopped in their seats. There was your coat, a big interruption in everybody's destination. When I picked it up, it scalded my hand like an unbearable red I saw once on a woman coming toward me. We had a 40-year reunion right there on the street, as if the coat had met us again in its afterlife. We were that glad, hugging it between us. Then you put it on and checked yourself in the store window, wearing yourself those moments to see forgiveness take your shape, then catching in the light of those walking through you. I suppose it was gratitude, your wearing it with telescopes, me putting my hand in your pocket, pretending to rob you while you looked for the first time at the four moons of Jupiter. Some weeks later, you write your coat was stolen after a long night of drinking and music. They took all your money. You never saw it again. I am in a state of mourning for your coat, which traveled with us that while, like a close relative concealing a fatal illness in a last visit. I remember a heart doctor who saved a man for 10 hours, so his wife disappeared into hope and would not come back, and would not take her lips from his until they wheeled him away. I make too much of this. Your coat, which, stolen or lost, did not belong to me, which I never wore. This poem was generated by seeing a horse in a field in Mexico, and the people had left the saddle on the horse, and it was terribly hot. The cloudy shoulders of the horses. We have thought of our horse to take his saddle off so he stands near us with his back free. His quick skin ripples with the weight lifted away. In the brown shallow the minnows of the flesh go darting. To be tied by the neck to that deliberate tree causes a shift of light on the river. No, I say, let the horse drink, Let the reins drag in the flow and the bit go silver cold. Let this be called Slave River. We raise our heads to see if the world has waited. We, who that moment were a thought so unobliged, there will be lives to pay for it back there in the city, where they are trading shovels for spoons, a crop for a day at the wheel. Spoiled shapes on the water, we drink from the leaves and wings above us, from the drifting shoulders of the horses. And this is entitled From Dread in the Eyes of Horses. And it came from reading that in Arabia, when the foals are born, they are given into the care of the women. They are actually taken into the household. And then once the foal is raised, the foal is taken from the house and given into the charge of the men and schooled in racing. From Dread in the Eyes of Horses. Eggs, dates, and camel's milk, give this. In 1 hour the foal will stand, in two will run. The care then of women, the schooling from fear, clamor of household, a prospect of saddles. They kneel to it, folded on its four perfect legs, stroke the good back, the muscles bunched at the chest. Its head, how the will shines large in it as what may be used to overcome it. The women of the horses comb out their cruel histories of hair, only for the pleasure of horses, for the lost mares on the ridge of yellow horses, their white arms praying the hair down breasts ordinary as knees. The extent of their power, this intimation of sexual wealth, from dread in the eyes of horses are taken their songs. In the white forests, the last free horses eat branches and roots, are hunted like deer, and carry no one. A wedge of light where the doorway opens the room, in it a sickness of sleep. The arms of the women, their coarse white hair. In a bank of sunlight, a man whitewashes the house he owns, no shores, no worlds above it, and farther, shrill, obsidian, the high feasting of the horses. Some with wings, some with manes. About a neighbor that I met in El Paso, Texas. Over the stone wall her hand comes, each knuckle enlarged to a miniature skull. She reaches into my rented yard to call me neighbor. Sunlight dazzles her spectacles, and in the chromium glint of her walker, she is bright royalty on an errand of magnitude. An effort to stand, an effort to step the pain carefully around invisible parameters, and still to say effort is nobility. Her hands are perfectly good for pointing. That small bare tree near my walkway, if pruned, would be heavy with peaches the size of your fist by July. In new regard, I think what it could and will do. Then, not to demean its offering, keep the next thought that I'll be gone by summer. She has the name of a workhorse I knew in Missouri, Dolly, and has outlived a sister to the same disease. She sat down with it, and that was the end of her. Such variations on reluctance caused me to see a kite, stubborn in a childhood pear tree, still abash in the wind with its complication of branches. I sighted my days by its banners until the tree caressed it into flight one day I wasn't looking. For didn't the memory of the tree go with it, the shred of it, less articulate by then, a slip of motion, longing to wrap itself in a tattered lunge at the whole air? After that, the tree said only the same thing other trees say before coming to fruit. Somehow we knew in our child hearts, when a thing is ruined, not to meddle with ecstasy by setting it free. We left it, though it ruffles the mind yet. Sitting in the darkened afternoon of her living room, I hear the death of the only daughter, meet the husband who loves eggs and sweets, says little. I'm the last of my family, she says. Then, in the walker, leads me down the grassy corridor to a room sleeping like a princess. The spell, I see, is in the elaborate coverlet. She will teach me how to do it. It took me 14 months of evenings, the hands now going out to the stitched pieces, remembering they have done this. I know I will never do it, will be gone by summer. What is it called? Cathedral windows, she says, and the raised light of her hands falls over me. And in this poem, the speakers are the dead, and they get the last word. It's called Tableau Vivant. They think it's easy to be dead, those who walk the pathway here in stylish shoes, portable radios strapped to their arms, selling the world's perishables, even love songs. They think you just lie down into dreams you will never tell anyone. They don't know we still have plans, a yen for romance, and miss things like hats and casseroles. As for dreams, we take up where the living leave off. We like especially those in which the dreamer is about to fall over a cliff or from a bridge that is falling too. We're only too glad to look down on the river gorge enlarging under a body's sudden weight, to have the ground rushing up instead of this slow caving in. We thrive on living out the last precious memories of someone escaped back into morning light. Occasionally, there's a message saying they want one of us back. Someone out there feeling guilty about a word or deed that seems worse because we took it as a living harm, then died with it quietly. But we know a lot about forgiveness, and we always make these trips with a certain missionary zeal. We get back into our old, sad clothes. We stand again at the parting, full of wronged tenderness and needing a shave or a hairdo. We tell them things are okay, not to waste their lives in remorse. We never held it against them. So much happens that no one means. But sometimes one of us gets stubborn, thinks of evening the score. We leave them calling after us, sorry, 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 and we don't look back. This poem was written in Tucson, Arizona, after my house had been vandalized, and there was quite a lot of damage done to the walls, the interior walls of the house. And after I had gotten that painted and cleaned up, I thought that the whole house needed its aspect cheered up, so I hired a man to paint the outside. And it was very hot, so that he had to start almost before it was daylight. And the particular morning that he was to come, I was having a dream in which I had the sensation of a paintbrush against the house, but it was almost as though I was experiencing being the wall with the brush touching me. It was a Then I woke up and found out that the man actually was already at his painting, and that his paintbrush seemed to have penetrated my dream in some way. Willingly. When I get up, he has been long at work, his brush limber against the house. Seeing him on his ladder under the eaves, I look back on myself asleep in the dream I could not carry awake. Sleep inside a house that is being painted. Whole lifetimes now, only the familiar cast of morning light over the prayer plant. This not remembering is something new of where you have been. What was settled or unsettled in sleep stays there, but your house under his steady arm is leaving itself, and you see this gradual surface of new light covering your sleep has the greater power. You think now you felt brush strokes or the space between them, a motion bearing down on you, an accumulation of stars, each night of them, arranging over the roofs of entire cities. His careful strokes whiten the web, the swirl of wood grain blotted out like a breath stopped at the heart. Nothing has changed, you say faithlessly, but something has cleansed you past recognition. When you stand near his ladder looking up, he does not acknowledge you, and as from daylight in a dream you see your house has passed from you into the blessed hands of others. This is ownership, you think, arriving in the heady afterlife of paint smell. A deep opening goes on in you. Some paint has dropped onto your shoulder, as though light concealed an unsuspected weight. You think it has fallen through you. You think you have agreed to this, what has been done with your life, willingly. This is the first poem in Under Stars, and it's entitled Words Written Near a Candle. I was writing in a trailer house, which is a park near a graveyard, at a place called Ballandoon in the west of Ireland. And it's addressed to someone back in the States. Words Written Near a Candle. If I could begin anything, I'd say stop asking forgiveness, especially theirs, which was always the fault mentioned in your condition. Nettles could be feathers the moment they brush your ankle. At the same time, floods, earthquakes, the various slaveries hunchbacked near the fence to catch your glance. What is it to say that among the hired boats we carried our bodies well, cracked jokes, left the gaps in our lives and not the page? This far to learn, the boat does not touch the water. And if this is goodbye, it is a light nowhere near believing, and I am happy, and it is all right to make a distance of a nearness, to say, boat, I have left you behind. Boat, I am with you. Another poem out of that time in Ireland is entitled Woman Enough, and describes an encounter I had with some men who were digging a grave in this graveyard. Then I found out later that no women are ever present at the grave digging site, that it is purely a male ritual, and that it was only by virtue of my being a woman and an American woman alone that I was probably invited to share in the passing of the whiskey around the gravesite. And then ultimately what finally did happen was quite out of order. Woman Enough. Figures on a silent screen, they move into my window, its facing on the abbey yard, 6 men with spades and long-handled shovels. I had looked up, as I look up now across the strand where a small boat has drifted into the haze of mountains, or that child walks to the end of a dock. Both views let in sun. The bearded one throws off his coat and rolls his sleeves. 2 in their best clothes from offices in London lean against a stone, letting the shovels lift and slap. The others dodge in and out of sun, elbow high, the ground thickening. The boat closer, one oar flashing, pulled to the light and under, these voices a darker blade. A wind carries over, and I hear them call out to me. He was a wild one in his young days. You'll want to lock your door. He nods the bottle to bring me out. A drink to you, Peter Hart, man that I never knew, lover of cows and one good woman buried across the lake. He was a tall man, about my size, the one measuring face down in the gap. Wouldn't you like a big man, big as me, dusting his hands on his pants and lifted out. The boat head on now, so it stays. Try it on, go down. The sky, the stone blue of the sky, an edge of faces, hard looks as though they'd hauled me live into the open boats of their deaths. American woman, man enough in that country place to stand with skulls sifted and stacked beside the dirt pile, but woman then where none had stood, and them more men for that mistake to see me where he would lay. Not a word of this to Mary, you hear? Oh, he was a wild one. A wild one in his youth, sunny Peter Hart. The title poem is called Under Stars. I think I chose this title for the collection in order to do away with all of the boundaries that I felt in my life and in Ireland. Under Stars. The sleep of this night deepens because I have walked coatless from the house, carrying the white envelope. All night it will say one name in its little tin house by the roadside. I have raised the metal flag so its shadow under the road lamp leaves an imprint on the rain-heavy bushes. Now I will walk back, thinking of the few lights still on in the town a mile away. In the yellowed light of a kitchen, the mill worker has finished his coffee. His wife has laid out the white slices of bread on the counter. Now, while the bed they have left is still warm, I will think of you. You who are so far away, you have caused me to look up at the stars. Tonight they have not moved from childhood, those games played after dark. Again I walk into the wet grass toward the starry voices. Again I am the found one, intimate, returned by all I touch on the way. I'll go now to a couple of poems from Instructions to the Double. This poem is entitled The Woman Who Raised Goats, and it is about a fantasy, a recurring fantasy that I had for some years of becoming a dock worker. In the poem, you see that I don't have much of anyone to talk to and that I'm reduced to telling this fantasy to goats. The Woman Who Raised Goats. Dear ones, in those days it was otherwise. I was suited more to an obedience of windows. If anyone had asked, I would have said, windows are my prologue. My father worked on the docks in a cold little harbor, unhappily dedicated to what was needed by next and further harbors. my brothers succeeded him in this. But when I, in that town's forsaken luster, offered myself, the old men in the hiring hall creeled back in their chairs, fanning themselves with their cards, with their gloves. Saucy, they said, she's saucy. Denial, O my senators, takes a random shape. The matter drove me to wearing a fedora. Soon the gowns, the amiable forgeries, a powdery sailor, the blue silk pillow given by a great aunt, my name embroidered on it like a ship, the stitched horse, too, with its red plume and its bird eyes, glowing, glowing. There was the education of my sensibilities. All this is nothing to you. You have eaten my only dress, and the town drifts every day now toward the harbor. But always above the town, above the harbor, there is the town, the harbor, the caves and hollows when the cargo of lights is gone. This poem is a poem I wrote in order to teach myself something which probably all people, but especially women, have needed to learn. That is to say no. Until you learn this skill, you have about half a life. Beginning to say no. Beginning to say no is not to offer so much as a fist, is to walk away firmly, as though you had settled something foolish, is to wear a tarantula in your buttonhole, yet smile invitingly, unmindful how your own blood grows toward the irreversible bite. No, I will not go with you. No, that is not all right. I'm not your sweet dish, your home-cooking, good-looking daffodil. Yes is no reason to slay the cyclops. No, will not save it. And the cricket, yes, yes. Fresh bait, fresh bait. The search for the right hesitation includes finally unobstructed waters. Goodbye, old happy-go-anyhow, old shoe for any weather. Whose candelabra are you? Whose soft guy, never mind, nothing to lose, ant hill? And the despised connective is really an engine until it is yes all day, until a light is thrown against a wall with some result, and there is less doubt, yes or no, for whatever you have been compelled to say more than once. The next poem does present a rather ugly emotion. That is the feeling of vengeance, which you don't like to see in yourself. It was a poem which was generated by the murder of my uncle in 1972 by three men who came down in the middle of the night and were looking for money, and they shot him and then burned him in the house. The absence. I am writing this out of vengeance, which is a hurt given to the self in the name of another. It has to do with becoming a purpose, which is an absence not unlike a gun. A man fired one into an ocean in back of my house. It was an act of bravery. The birds went free because it was my back porch and an ocean behind it. He knew a target when he saw one, those fists loose in his eye. That is the way of targets, one as good as another, until you decide. The ocean was there, and a recognition of the gun for the ocean, and the need, too, of the man to leave himself out, which is a way of beginning again. I am writing this out of vengeance, and the word because has nothing to do with it. The reason forgets itself. The man has fired the gun and the ocean. What did you mean? The man and the ocean. The gun has fired. The ocean is becoming a purpose, I can say, and we are becoming more than the gun. This water emptying without a sign. Last poem I'll read is entitled The Calm. We were walking through the bees and stars. Our mouths made a sense without us. I loved your hands because of your mouth, each star because of a life not chosen by the hand. I told you, don't say it, the loss of our lives beyond us. You said it for the sake of a loneliness together, for the praise of our eyes going on without shadows. Even now, when all our nights have washed away and the apples have left the trees, I am keeping your place where the high grass has entered the song. Like a swarm, the heart moves with its separate wings under the eaves. If I knew where to find you, I would say goodbye and have the hurtful ease of that. But the gates are everywhere, and this calm, an imagined forgiveness, the childhood before we meet again.